Hi everyone, sorry. I will present my thesis works about passive radar and specifically a methodology for the interlacing radar signal. Yes. This presentation is divided into five main parts. A first part will quickly introduce the subject and the main issues, followed by a presentation of the data. I will describe the proposed approach and then I present an application case before concluding. The technological evolution of the last few years has allowed many innovations in the electronic field and more particularly in the field of electronic warfare. Electronic equipment is becoming increasingly complex and sophisticated, leading to a transformation of the radar signal processing chain. The aim of my work is to use and develop machine learning tools for passive radar intelligence. But what is passive radar? It's a detection device that doesn't emit electromagnetic waves. It's only a receiver that can detect, track, and identify radars. Radar signal, the interlacing includes technicals able of separating, characterizing, and identifying all transmitter present in the signal. We have identified four main challenges about the data that make them complex. As we may know, some radars don't continuously transmit. When we work, the quality of the data is not always good. For example, sensors are not optimal. We have parasites, weak signal to noise ratio. We have some identifiability issues. Different radars may have very close, almost identical characteristics. For example, in airports or airborne. And the last, the volume and the heterogeneity of the data. We have signals of different sizes, from 50 observations to more than 1 million observations that may contain up than 10 radars. Given the impossibility of obtaining real labeled data, we used simulated data to obtain a large diversity of signals representing typical radars. Radars emit continuous observations and have their own characteristics. Among them, we will retain four features: frequency, pulse width, level, and time of arrival. Here is a representation of a simple simulated signal containing two transmitters. The first three features are plotted in the time of arrival plane, and the last plot represents the frequency pulse width plane. Among our four data, the radar zero, represented by the blue color, constitutes 96% of the observations and the 4% left by the brown color. On the graph at the bottom right, the observations are grouped together and form several distant blocks. The brown emitter is easily identifiable because it's represented by a single block in this plane. It's possible for a radar to have agility characteristics on one or more features. An emitter can be represented by several blocks as the observation packets from blue emitters. In some cases, it's also possible for the same emitter to transmit on several frequency bands with several pulse widths, creating many blocks and making identification more difficult. In our signal, they emit on very different frequency bands and in a regular way. We have implemented a two-step strategy for signal deinterlacing. First, a clustering algorithm is used to separate the observation in the frequency pulse width plane. Then, we will use the cluster output of the step one as a features for an hierarchical agglomerative clustering combined with optimal transport distances. Step one, clustering with HDB scan. We apply clustering algorithm on two features, frequency and pulse width. Why we use the HDB scan? Because it's an unsupervised algorithm that allows us to search for clusters of varying densities. And most of the parameters are auto-integrated by optimization strategy. The HDB scan algorithm has been set up to overestimate the number of cluster formed. In fact, underestimating the number of clusters could lead to group the observations from several different emitters. For example, we could have some emitters with only few observations or emitting very little of the time. Here are the result of the clustering. HGBScan identifies 7 clusters from this signal with an addition and outlier class. We add the specific outlier class in order to denoise and improve the unicity of cluster results. The other clusters have heterogeneous sizes, as you can see on the table. The plot shows an observation spread diagram in the frequency pulse width plane. Each color represents an identified cluster. As we can see, we found the cluster number 0, which is separate from other. The specific cluster is well identified as it's coming from one given emitter, whereas the second emitter was split in 6 clusters. Step 2, cluster fusion. From the HGBScan cluster, a hierarchical clustering was built using the optimal transport distances. This step assumes that the cluster from a radar will be active at the same time periods. Firstly, we applied a dimension reduction. Each cluster is represented by an histogram of its time of arrival. Secondly, we compute distances between cluster histograms using optimal transport. Thirdly, the 2 closest clusters are aggregated by using the lowest transport cost. Fourthly, distances are updated. And then these steps are repeated until a single cluster is obtained. On the right, you can see the time of arrival histograms of 3 clusters. Green and red belong to the same transmitter. They are very similar. You can see that the clusters are active at the same time. In the strategy of aggregation, the red and green will be grouped together. This group is very natural. To quantify this similarity, we use an optimal transport distance, which is defined as the cost to move the point from one place to another. For these 2 clusters, this cost will be defined as the lowest. On the other hand, green and blue don't belong to the same radar and are not active at the same time. There will be a lot of moving to change the points, so they have a high transport cost. In conclusion, the comparison of the transport cost of distribution from histogram allows us to detect if 2 clusters belong to the same radar. As written on the slide, transporting distribution to another has a cost. The total cost is calculated as the sum of all costs to move all points from one location to another. Of all these possible costs, the smallest is taken. Therefore, we are solving a linear minimization problem. The dendrogram presents in the simplified way the aggregation of clusters at each step. Several metrics are used to create a decision model to determine what to cut the dendrogram and specify the final grouping. The decisional model was mainly built from 3 metrics: silhouette score, Kalinskarp score, and Davis-Boulding score. We have set up a majority or eigennumber of cluster rules to select where to stop fusion. The silhouette and the Kalinskarp score should be maximized, whereas the third one is minimized. Here are the results of the metrics used at the different steps of fusion. The silhouette and Davis-Boulding score show us that clusters should be aggregated until we get 2, while the Kalinskarp score shows that this is optimal when we get 6 clusters. The decisional model will finally select 2 clusters. Here's the final result. The clustering has worked perfectly and correctly identified the 2 transmitters present in this signal. But we note that 7% of the observations could not be correctly identified because they are at the border of the cluster and couldn't be identified as the first step. We have now built a consistent methodology based on simple data. I'm going to present you an application case on slightly more complex data. This plot represents a signal using its primary parameter, frequency, pulse width, level, time of arrival, and difference of time of arrival. We have the size of a signal with more than 150,000 observations. This signal is more complicated than the previous one because there are photon emitters, which are split into several blocks on the frequency pulse width plane, as you can see on the left plot. We know that difference of time of arrival is really used in radar identification. It has been calculated on the whole signal, but not used at this step because it doesn't make sense. The difference of time of arrival is calculated between successive observations, which don't necessarily belong to the same radar, especially when there are several active radars at the same time. For example, the Lovell time of arrival plane in the bottom left plot shows an overlapping of the lobe around 5.6 microseconds. Here are the results of HDB scan clustering in the frequency pulse width plane. Color represents the 11 different clusters written by the algorithm, including outlier class. Clusters are distributed along the lobes in the Lovell time of arrival plane. From the HDB scan clusters, a hierarchical agglomerative clustering was built using the optimal transfer distances. At each step, the optimal transfer distance between each pair of cluster are computed. The pair of clusters with the smallest distance is merged into a single cluster. This step is repeated until the clusters are fully aggregated. The dendrogram was cut using decision rules. The decisional model indicates that the dendrogram must be cut so that four clusters remain. The red line is used to identify cluster. This is the final grouping of cluster according to hierarchical agglomerative clustering with optimal transport. We used the dendrogram to group cluster and obtain this representation. Our methodology is validated and correctly identifies the four transmitters present in this more complex signal. The difference of time of arrival was recalculated from the observations of each emitter. We can see patterns and know it makes sense. It allows to check the quality of the cluster fusion and can be used as a new feature for classification. On the other hand, 0.6% of the data is not classified because they are excluded by the HDB scan at step one. To conclude, our methodology, as we have seen, works on moderately complex cases with typical radar. This method gave very good results on simulated data sets and encouraging results on real data. For the moment, we assume that the cluster returned by HDB scan contained the observation of only one transmitter. But it's possible that two radars have identical frequency and pulse width. We are working on improvement in the separation of similar radar in frequency and pulse width. The next objectives will investigate the usage of optimal transport in three particular challenging cases. Primary, when a cluster is underrepresented. Second case, when a radar has a strong frequency sweep. And finally, get a better decision model regarding the best cut in the dendrogram. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much, Manon, for this very interesting presentation. It's a dumb question, but you mentioned electronic warfare as an application. So my question would be, do you think this kind of method would be adaptable in an online setting? Or do you just want to be able to treat these signals afterwards?
It's the next step. For the moment, we treat with this method, but in the future we want to treat in real time. Want to apply this method in real time.
Okay, and also, so I have no knowledge about radars, but my intuition would be that there would be a lot of noise in this kind of signal. So maybe it's wrong, but if it is the case, what How would you be able to treat the noise specifically?
This is the next challenges because for the moment we treat general cases when we have a lot of noises, but we have some signal exception with a lot of noise, and this work is in improvement.
Okay, well, thank you again, Manon, for your presentation.